Abraham anymore, because you're living in Zinedown.
The prophets all agreed that the one to come will be born in Bethlehem. Jesus was born in Bethlehem. I could go on and on and on, because all the Jews, you go and speak to a Jew, an Orthodox Jew, because we're talking about thousands of years of history. Now these Jews, they love God. They left Egypt and they saw God part the Red Sea. So when God sent them prophets, they wrote down who that Messiah was going to be and what he was going to do, where he was going to be born. And whoever would come and say he's the Messiah, they better fit those prophecies. So people came and went. People came and went, and they hoped for that Messiah until Jesus came. Jesus came, but the only one thing that the Jews missed. Bless them. They were waiting for Jesus to come with physical power to conquer Rome, to rule the earth and be peace on the land. God bless the Jews. They missed him. But you see, God, in his wisdom, he had to fulfill scripture, because the Jews had to reject him for all of us to be welcome into the kingdom. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Amen.
The Jews had to crucify him. It was prophesied. You go to Isaiah 53, the suffering servant. I suggest you read it. Go to Psalm 22. It talks about the crucifixion of Jesus, even down to the point of where they were casting lots for his clothes. Minute details Jesus fulfilled. Even when he said, my God, why have thou forsaken me? He was quoting Psalm 22. He wasn't crying out for help. He's God. What help does he need? He was showing people, I am he. I am the one. And I don't come with physical power. I come with spiritual power to free you from the chains of the law. The law bound people and put them under slavery. That's why we can't keep it. God sent the law so that we would know we are incapable. That's why he sent the law, to show us that we need a savior. And when Jesus came, he said, think not that I come to abolish the law, I come to fulfill it. And he fulfilled the law by removing the physical and opening the eyes of the spiritual being. And say, it's not what goes into a man that defiles him, it's what comes out of the heart. He directed the eyes of the physical being, the physical people, all of us, inwardly. The Jew is walking away. That's what they did. But listen, he gave us messages. There's no other message in the world that can even come close to the message of Jesus. Oh yeah, there's love this and love that. But which other message gives you a directive to love your enemies? Which other? It is the hardest thing to do, because naturally as human beings, we want to hate. Hate you because you hate me. I'll take revenge on you because he did this to me. And Jesus said, turn away from the physical and look into your heart and be right before me. On the cross, he said, Father, forgive them, because they don't know what they're doing. The Jews didn't realize what they were doing. Even today, we don't know what we're doing. We're going around like blind mice. God is calling us back to himself through Jesus Christ. He loves every one of us, and he knew we couldn't keep the law. And the Father said, Son, today I've begotten thee. Oh. and be the sacrifice. That Passover lamb without spot or blemish. Fulfill the law that my children cannot. Take their place of the penalty of sin on the cross that we deserve. He took it upon himself, all of our faults, all of our sins. Jesus took it on himself. How dare we turn our backs on him? How dare we think that we are our own gods and we can handle it, when inwardly every man knows and every woman knows, when you're alone with your thoughts at night, you can't hack it. You know you can't hack it. You ain't fooling no one. We're all flesh and blood. And it doesn't matter how many times you go and do Salah, it's the law. Prayers won't save you. Zakat won't save you. Krishna won't save you. Buddha won't save you. Nobody will save you apart from the one and only Jesus Christ, the Son of God in the living flesh, who left heaven and humbled himself and became obedient to the Father. Even to death on the cross, he took our sins. And he nailed them to the cross. He nailed the law to the cross. He said, no more is it about keeping the law. Even though, yes, we have to walk in righteousness, but we are not bound by the condemnation of the law. We are under grace. He brought us grace. He gave us what we don't deserve, which is life. And he did give us what we do deserve, which is death. What a wonderful God I serve. And that's why we come here every week. Doesn't matter if my life goes, bottom line, because I know that this message is too important to keep to myself, because I'm a wicked man. I'm sure there's a wickeder man than there in this crowd than me. I'm a wicked man. Trust me. Trust me. I should be dead for the things I did to people, the places I went, the dark corners I hid in. I should be dead. But God in his mercy redeemed me and showed me that light, and he sent me here to tell you there is only one name given unto men whereby you must be saved. One! No other. Listen very carefully. No other name given unto men whereby you must be saved. Only Jesus Christ. Listen to what I'm saying. Now the devil comes to kill, to steal, and destroy that knowledge. He sends people like Muhammad. He sent people like Krishna to you. He sent people like Buddha to you. He tells you that if you build a statue that can't talk, can't walk, can't breathe, somehow you can reach God. How can you worship your own creation? How stupid is mankind? Why don't we look outside of ourselves and realize that it all adds up? It all adds up. Now the one thing that the devil doesn't want you to know is that you have a way out, an easy way out. You don't have to pray 5 times a day, 10 times a day, wear this, do this, comb your hair to the right, to the left, go to the toilet with your right foot first. You don't have to do any of that stuff, because Jesus came to set you free.
Amen.
Free indeed! So that he wants to know you on an individual, personal basis. That's the whole reason. He wants that big connection with you. He wants to walk with you in the garden like he did with Adam and Eve. God was in Jesus Christ reconciling man to himself. So now,
hold on, wait.
So now, I want to let you into a little secret that maybe if you haven't studied enough, if you haven't studied enough, you missed. There is only one thing that would save. Of course, I said it's Jesus, but one thing you have to acknowledge, that Jesus died for us, and he rose again on the third day to justify us through faith. You must believe. Romans 10:9 says, if you confess with your mouth and believe in your heart, just believe. It's only faith, no works. Confess with your mouth and believe in your heart that Jesus Christ is Lord and that God raised him from the dead, and you shall be saved. It's the promise of God. God is not a liar. Now the devil didn't like that because it's very easy, isn't it? All you have to do is acknowledge that Jesus is God and that he died for our sins in our place. And believe it in your heart and it's done. So what does the devil do? He goes to a pagan like Muhammad. He goes to a man that was a pagan. His family was pagan. A man that was sacrificing lambs to Manat, who's a pagan idol, who used to go into Hira and worship Allah as a pagan. And he came to Muhammad and he attacked him like a demon. The Bible says even Satan can come as an angel of light. And that's what the devil did. He used Muhammad as a pawn. I challenge anyone here to go into the Bible. Right? Find a place, one place, and I'll leave this park and I won't come back. Just one place where Gabriel appears to somebody and does not introduce himself. Gabriel appeared 3 times. Zechariah, Daniel, Mary. Always introduce himself because people were afraid. You see an angelic being, you become afraid. The first thing that God does, he puts you at peace. The first thing, I am Gabriel, I stand in the presence of God. Fear not. What happened to Muhammad? Muhammad got squeezed 3 times. Let me break it down. This man, he said, squeezed him so hard that he couldn't breathe. Where did Gabriel do that in the Bible? Where? Gabriel never touched anyone. He came and sent a message and he went, done. Muhammad said, I can't read. He said, read. What kind of stupidness? He's stupid already. He's asking him to read and there's nothing to read. Muhammad is illiterate. Doesn't God know Muhammad can't read? He squeezed Muhammad till he couldn't breathe. He ran out of that cave screaming. A fear that he was possessed by a demon. He ran to his wife. Does it sound like a demon to you? Doesn't sound like an angel. He ran to his wife Khadija. He was a toy boy. He married her for money. Married her for money, waiting for position. Because they chased him out of Mecca. Oh no, I'm getting ahead of myself. Anyway, he married Khadija for money. He said, Khadija, cover me, cover me. His neck muscles were twitching. That's what the Islamic sources say. Think about it, it sounds like a possession. Muhammad didn't know it was an angel. Khadija didn't know it was an angel. So Khadija took Muhammad and took him to her cousin, Waraka bin Auf, they say he's a Christian, but there are many people mentioned in the Quran which are not Christians, they're called Nasara. They are offbeat, heretic. Muhammad didn't know this though, because he never met Jesus, never spoke to Jesus, never had nothing to do with Jesus. Neither did Waraka, he was in Arabia. Jesus came from Jerusalem. So they developed stories that were off. So when Muhammad went to Waraka, told him the story, he doesn't want to know. Walking away from salvation, that he knows. Why not challenge what I'm saying? Challenge what I'm saying. Waraka said this is the same Gabriel that appeared to Moses. That's what Waraka told Khadija and told Muhammad. Now I challenge anybody here to find for me in the Bible, I'll give you 100,000 years, where Gabriel ever appeared to Moses. Does anybody know? Put me in my place. Let me tell you, Gabriel never appeared to Moses. Islam started with misinformation, and Muhammad has come and told you and given you an antichrist doctrine in opposition to everything that Jesus came and told you. Jesus came to give you grace. And Muhammad to set you free, Muhammad came to give you laws to bind you up. And he told you, Jesus never died and he never rose again. The one thing that will save us, Muhammad said it didn't happen. Because he is a fool of Satan. And Jesus said many will come after me, false prophets. Don't follow them. If anybody preach a different gospel, let them be accursed. Muhammad has a different gospel. He's an antichrist and he is accursed. Look at a man's life. I want to encourage everybody today, if there's any Christians here, I want to encourage everybody today, Christians, be strong. Not in the physical. Remember what Jesus came with. In your heart and in the spirit, in the Holy Spirit, be strong. And do not fear. Because even in this park we are outnumbered, but we are not really. Because we have God by our side.
Amen.
If they insult you, do not return insult for insult. Do not return evil for evil. If you are hated, reviled for the gospel, soak it up. Because that's what Jesus did. And it's him we follow. They might call you weak, but how much strength does it take not to take someone down to the floor when they insult your mother? It takes strength. It takes the Spirit of God to show you that you are higher, called to Christ, and to give a message. Jesus said you are a city set on a hill. How will they know you if you behave like them? How will they know? You have to be a light. You have to be a beacon. They have to look at you and say, hold on, why hasn't he hit me yet? Why hasn't he cursed me yet? I'm cursing him. You must be a light of the world. Do not lose your flavor. Jesus said you are the salt of the earth. Do not lose your flavor. Walk in the spirit. If you lose your flavor,